Good morning. Welcome this morning. We're glad you could join us. Before we begin, I'd like to read a verse real quick, or a passage real quick. Psalm 95, verse 1. Come, let's shout joyfully to the Lord. Shout triumphantly to the rock of our salvation. Let's enter his presence with thanksgiving. Let's shout triumphantly to him in song. For the Lord is a great God, a great King above all gods. The depths of the earth are in his hand, and the mountain peaks are his. The sea is his, he made it. His hands formed the dry land. Come, let's worship and bow down. Let's kneel before the Lord, our Maker. This morning, we're coming before the Lord. This is a time that's about him. It's not about us. Our focus, our attention, our minds are not on ourselves and our own lives, but they're of him and his good works and his goodness and how loving, a great loving Father that he is. Let's go to the Lord in prayer. Father God, we are thankful that we get this opportunity to come and to gather and to worship you. This morning, we lay aside all the things that we care about and that concern us in our life. We turn our focus and we turn our attention and our adoration to you, Father. We lift up your name. We praise you for how good you are and how you are in control of all things. Nothing is outside of your control. We are so thankful that you love us so dearly. In your name we pray. Amen. If you're able, please stand with us as we worship. And welcome to those of you who are joining us online who couldn't make it this morning. Welcome. Please worship with us.
Thank you. been lifted. Grace is waiting for you. Dance like the weight has been lifted. Grace is waiting. Sing it with me. Dance like the weight has been lifted. Grace is waiting for you. Dance like the weight has been lifted. Grace is.
Sing it one more time. Dance.
Dance like the weight has been lifted. Grace is waiting for you.
It's running after me. With my life laid down, goodness is running after, it's running after me.
For all my life you have been faithful. All my life you have been so, so good. With every breath that I am able, oh, I'm gonna sing of the goodness of God.
Goodness of God. Would you just join together with me? Let's not ask Him for nothing right now. Let's just continue the worship and the praise through just adoring Him in your own way. Using your words, just love Him. Just appreciate Him right now, would you? Just magnify Him. Lift up your hearts. Lift up your hands. Let's lift up our voices. Hallelujah. Let's magnify Him in this place. Oh, Father God. Hallelujah, in the name of Jesus, name above all names, hallelujah. Oh, my Lord and my God, the Redeemer of my soul, you are the King of kings, you are the Lord of lords. Oh, hallelujah, as I bask in your presence, I lift up my voice, I lift up my heart, I lift up my hands, and I rejoice in you. Hallelujah, when I think of your goodness, when I think of your mercies, oh, when I consider your mighty, mighty grace that's ever growing, oh God, when I consider the blessings that you bless me with each and every day, hallelujah, oh, you heap them upon us each day, I rejoice, oh, when I think of your forgiveness, oh my God, when I think of your divine healing, oh, when I think of that miraculous power, Lord God, that you extend to your children, I rejoice and I magnify the name of Jesus. I bless your holy name, Lord. I bless your holy name. Hallelujah. 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 Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. Come on, give Him a good hand clap offering of praise in this place. Come on. Come on. Hallelujah. Thank you, Lord. Oh, we bless your holy name. How good it is to be together to worship the Lord in the sanctuary and corporate worship. For those that are joining us online, God bless you. We are thankful that you're with us today through media, and what a time it is to rejoice today in the Lord. He's so, so good. Amen and amen. We're going to lift up the lights and just see those who are among us here. If you want to wave at somebody, please do so. And if you want to move around, if someone remains seated, just respect their space if you would. And you can shake a hand if that's what they desire to do, but otherwise just wave and show your love and appreciation from a distance. And hallelujah. So good to see everybody. Amen. Give them a smile. Everybody needs a smile. You know, even with a mask on, you can see through the eyes a smile. Did you know that? Yeah, sure you can. God bless you today. Hallelujah. Praise the Lord. Well, God bless you today. I have the privilege of continuing to lead us in worship and in praise through returning tithe to the Lord by giving an offering unto the Lord. This is worship. Amen. This is extending our worship and saying, God, thank you for what you've provided in my life. Therefore, I return what you've asked me to return. I return that tenth. I may give up and above an offering. And this is something that we do as a part of our worship and service as Christians. This is a part of our responsibility. This is a part of our worship and praise. We don't want to leave that an empty spot. Amen. In our lives. And we desire the blessings of God today. If you have one of your Connect cards, it should be right in front of you. Please be sure to pick one of those up and fill those out. That's just a way of knowing who is here, and we can connect with you that way. And we wish you would fill one of those out, whether you come every Sunday or not. We want you to fill one of those out, please. And in our giving today, you can see up on the screen that there's several avenues of giving. So, you know, we can do it whichever way is most convenient for you. There's also a portal in the back where you can find a way to give as well through the kiosk in the back. And so do it whichever. You can do it through check. You can do it through cash, whatever. Just let's give back to God today. I ask our ushers to come if they would, those that would help us today in giving. And would you just with me today, just thank God for this time of giving, the privilege. It is a privilege today to be able to give back to God and honor Him in this way. Thank you, Jesus, for the privilege of giving, the privilege of returning, Lord, what you blessed us with. Without you, Lord, we would have nothing. You are our supplier. You're the one that provides. And therefore, we just honor you through the giving of the tenth, through the offering that we also give. Let this bring honor and glory to you. Thank you, Jesus, for this time we have together in extending this worship time and giving. In Jesus' name. Would you say a nice big amen? Amen. God bless you today.
Thank you, Lord Jesus. Hallelujah. With our heads bowed, our eyes closed, why don't you just lift your hands toward heaven and take a moment and just say, how marvelous, how wonderful, and my song shall ever be. Oh, how marvelous, how wonderful is my Savior's love for me. Hallelujah. If you love him this morning, let him hear it. Come on, make some noise and clap your hands and give him a shout of praise. A shout of triumph. Glory to God. I love these songs about the love of God and the freedom we have in the Spirit of God. And I love to hear Sherry Williams leading us in worship. And boy, is it good to have her back after a couple weeks that she was gone. We appreciate you, Sherry. Thank you so much for leading us and our whole team. You guys are amazing. Really awesome you are. Truly awesome. Amen. I would like to ask the kids to come, the 4 through 11-year-olds. Just come on down here and make your way toward the stairs, the 4 through 9-year-olds this way. If you're 10, 11, or 12, you can go this way or out the back. And we got a couple of wonderful classes, Life Kids and The Loop, upstairs for our kids. And we love our kids. Give our kids a big hand, would you please? Our workers and everyone who serves. Man, I looked up and saw Curtis Ayers this morning in service with us. And I tell you, it's good to see you, buddy. That guy was in bad shape. You wound up in 4 hospitals? Is that right? Oh, my. I'm thankful you're here this morning and looking good, going strong, right? Amen. Amen. We're glad everyone's here, and we welcome our online group, the audience this morning, perhaps couldn't make it out or still not comfortable being around crowds and so forth. We understand. That's okay. We're not going to fuss at anyone. We're just glad you've tuned us in. We're glad that you're taking the time to worship with us and to hear the word preached. We're going to preach in just a moment. In fact, I'd like for you to take your thoughts and your heart and just open up your minds, and let's just trust the Lord for a great continuation of this service. Hasn't this been good so far? Have you just enjoyed the presence of God? It's been so good and so rich and so sweet, and we thank the Lord for it. You know, I'm going to be preaching this morning. My title will be Citizenship of Another Country. Citizenship of Another Country, Another Land. I brought with me this morning my newest passport, and I brought it so I just thought I would kind of reflect and remember what a passport's all about. With this passport, I can travel just about anywhere in the world. It's a passport of the United States of America. And I tell you what, I feel very, very comfortable when I'm traveling with this document in my hand. It proves that I'm a citizen of the United States of America. That's my physical citizenship. However, I have a spiritual citizenship. I am a citizen of another country. I'm simply an alien. Hello? You're like, I knew there was something about that preacher. I'm an alien. You're an alien. We're simply passing through this land. This is not our home. I said, Earth is not our home. We have a great home. If you're born again, if you're a child of God, then you have a great home in heaven. Eyes have not seen, ears have not heard, neither has it entered the heart of man, the things which God has prepared for us. Jesus said in John 14, he told his disciples, he said, listen, I've got to go away, but if you believe in God, believe also in me. For in my Father's house are many rooms. If it were not so, I would have told you, but I go to prepare a place for you. And if I go, I will come again and receive you unto myself, that where I am, there you may be also. Are you glad you have a place other than this earth? We have a life after this life. Eternity, my friend, is for those who love the Lord Jesus and trust him. We're going to share eternity and spend eternity with the Lord in his presence with his people, and it's going to be a glorious time. Somebody say amen, amen, amen. I was made mindful of a lady, the only person I've ever known of who could travel without a passport, the Queen of England. Queen Elizabeth has been to 120 nations. She's in her 90s now. And her son, Charles, Prince Charles, is like, come on, Mom. go on to heaven or wherever you're going. It's my time. But anyway, she's 92. She has served as the Queen of England in the British Commonwealth since she was in her 20s when her father died. And she became the queen. And she's traveled and she's traveled and she's traveled. And it's amazing. I mean, just absolutely amazing to me what this lady has done. And she travels with, let me see if I can get this right here. She travels with an entourage of 34 people. And she has, out of that 34 people, she has 6 bodyguards. And she has, I don't want to be misquoted here. Let's see, 6 secretaries, 8 bodyguards. I don't know why you need 6 secretaries, but she brings them along with her. And she has 2 ladies in waiting, and then she has 2 dressers. So there are at least 4 people to get her, help her get dressed in those bright pastel outfits and hats that she wears. When she travels, she carries her own food and water, just in case wherever she's going doesn't have the right stuff. They're bringing stuff that she likes. She brings a couple of units of blood in case those are needed. She travels with a nurse and a doctor, and at all times, an entourage of 34 people travel with the Queen of England everywhere that she goes. 40 different trunks and suitcases of clothing. Ladies, she has dozens of outfits that she travels with. In case she doesn't feel like pink today, maybe she feels like coral. It's not a coral kind of a day. Maybe it's a mint green kind of a day. And so she dresses and prepares her hat. And she travels. I told you she travels without a passport because all of the passports in the British Commonwealth are issued under the authority of the Queen of England. So it's kind of silly for her to issue herself a passport and give herself permission to travel around the world. So here's a lady who travels. Her citizenship is British, but she travels around the world without a passport. I thought that was fascinating. Thought I would just share that with you this morning. There's been a lot of turmoil and questioning and restlessness and anxiety in the last few days. I visited with one of our church members recently who told me that their blood pressure had just gone through the roof. And I said, what do you mean your blood pressure is high? They told me, they said, it's about this election. It's about this politics. It's about what's going on. She didn't get her guy in office. And so she's fretful and she's anxious. And I told her, I said, listen, as a child of God, we are citizens of another country. And it doesn't matter if a Democrat's on the throne or a Republican's on the throne or an independent's on the throne. It doesn't matter what happens in the White House. What's important is what happens in your house. What's truly important is that you know the Lord Jesus and are spending your life glorifying God and advancing His kingdom. Listen, ladies and gentlemen, there are two kingdoms at work in the earth today. One is the kingdom of darkness. The other is the kingdom of light. The kingdom of darkness is ruled by Satan, Lucifer, Slewfoot. He is the fallen angel that rebelled against God, the Bible teaches us, and was kicked out of heaven. So he basically has a pink slip. He lost his one and only job and is now in charge of causing men and women like us to rebel and to sin, and he's trying to tempt us and lead us the wrong way so that we might stay in the kingdom of darkness. You see, every person born onto the planet, they're technically in the kingdom of darkness, their spirit. That's why a little child, a teenager, they need to be born again. If you're an adult here this morning and you've never been born again, Jesus said in John chapter 3 to Nicodemus, he said, don't marvel at the fact that you must be born again. And Nicodemus, who was a teacher of the law, he was a student of Jewish law, he's a member of the Sanhedrin Council. This guy was sharp. He'd committed so much of the Torah to memory and worked with it every single day. But yet he did not understand the spiritual concept of being born again. Listen, ladies and gentlemen, our natural minds don't comprehend and figure out everything that God's got for us. There are things that God gives to us that are not understood by our natural, fleshly, carnal minds, but the Spirit of God understands those things. And if you are born again, you have the Spirit of God within you, and you can grasp the revelation of truth, you can grasp the Word of God, and it can be applied to your heart. And if you're born again, say amen and give me a big shout this morning, would you? Born again. You must be born again a second time. Nicodemus said, how does this work? Do I enter my mother's womb and come out a second time? I don't understand. What do you mean, born again? So Jesus explained to him that there are two births. One is a birth by water, which is a natural fleshly birth. The other is a birth of the Spirit. And if you've only been born one time, you're going to die twice because you're going to die spiritually and you're going to die physically. But if you've been born twice, you're only going to die one time. It's appointed a man wants to die, and after that, the judgment. So your body's going to die, but the good news is if you're born again, your spirit's going to live forever with the Lord Jesus in the heaven that He's prepared for you and I. And you know, the older I get, the sweeter heaven gets. As I lose more of my friends and more of my ministry colleagues and more folks that I love dearly, as I lose them, heaven becomes sweeter and sweeter. I'll never forget in 1997 when my father passed away. And I'll never forget in 2009 when my mother passed away. I was at their side. I was doing my best to minister to them when they went. But you know, heaven has never been sweeter than it's been since my mom and my daddy went to heaven. I want to see them. I want to see all the patriarchs of the faith. I want to see all the New Testament saints. But the good news is I want to see Jesus. He's the one who died for me. He's the one who shed his blood at Calvary. He's the one who's made a way for me to be free and to break the chains of bondage we were singing about this morning. He's the one who brings us liberty and freedom. Somebody say amen. So I want to just encourage you to not be fretful during this time. Say, Pastor, what are we going to do? I don't know what's going to happen to the church? Friend, let me tell you, the church has endured 2,000 years of hardship, persecution. The church has endured being placed in hollow logs and being sawn in half. Because the church is us. The church is not a building or a bus or a budget. The church is a body of related believers. And through the years, through the centuries, for 2,000 years, the church has existed. And Jesus said to his disciples, he said, listen, I'm going to build my church. I'm going to build my church. And the gates of hell will not prevail against my church. So the church of Jesus Christ is still strong. You say, well, we've taken a real hit. People just aren't interested. People are falling away. This is a post-Christian nation. Listen, I don't care about all that. I know that the word of God is true. And as long as you and I are connected to the head of the church, Jesus Christ, we're going to be all right. He's going to bring us through with flying colors. And when it's time for him to take us home, he's going to take us away from this earth before the final wrath of God is poured out in tribulation upon the earth. They say, well, Pastor, there's tribulation happening now. Yes, there is. There's more persecution of Christians around the world today than at any other point in the last 2,000 years. Homes are being burned, churches being destroyed, people being killed, little children, adults, teenagers, they're being slaughtered in the name of some other religion. And so we've never seen persecution like we've seen right now. But however, this is not the great tribulation which is to come. This is not the dispensation of time, the 7-year period which will follow the rapture of the church. And God has not appointed you and I to wrath. Now, when I say you and I, I'm not talking about everybody. I'm talking about men and women who are born again. If you're at home and you're viewing this, you may be new to the gospel, new to the scriptures. You may have just stumbled on the Facebook page or the YouTube or however you found us. And I got news for you. If you're born again, then the good news is God has prepared a place for you and his wrath is not for you. The wrath of God will be poured out on unbelievers. It'll be poured out upon those who have not trusted Christ. He has given us 2,000 years of a dispensation, a time period of grace. Everybody say grace. God's given us his grace, his favor, his unmerited favor. He's given us all things that pertain to life and godliness. He's made a way for us. He's done everything that we need for 2,000 years. But this dispensation is going to come to an end. It's going to end in a cataclysmic failure on the part of mankind to govern himself and to raise himself up out of his morass of sinfulness and lawlessness and rebellion. And it takes a Savior. It takes God. It takes the Lord Jesus. And he will return again. And he will come back for his followers before the great tribulation is poured out on the earth. So, the book of Philippians, the 3rd chapter, I think is kind of where I'd like to start this morning. Philippians chapter 3 and verse 20. And I've got a feeling that this message may not be able, we may not conclude it in one session. We may have to go a couple more weeks with it, but we'll see what happens. This is the word, screen's out, sorry, projector's out. These are the words of the Apostle Paul, okay? And he's writing to the church at Philippi, and that's why we call it the book of Philippians. And he says to them, he says, listen, I want you to know that your citizenship, he actually says our, so he's including himself in this. He's writing, again, to Christians, all right? If you're not a Christian, this is not applicable to you. You're in the wrong kingdom. You're in the kingdom of darkness. You must be translated from that kingdom into the kingdom of his dear son, the kingdom of light. Jesus rules from the kingdom of light. Those two kingdoms are in constant opposition and conflict. The kingdom of darkness constantly trying to overcome the kingdom of light. But how many of you read somewhere that darkness cannot overcome the light? Amen? You take all the lights out of this room and light a candle. I mean, make it pitch dark. Trust me, this black box, it is pitch dark. There are no outside windows except if you can see through these on the sides. So it gets really dark in here. If you're dark in this room, but then light a candle. I want you to know that candle is going to put off enough light for everyone in the room to see the candle. Darkness cannot overcome the light. It never can, it never will. We're the church of Jesus Christ, my friend. Doesn't matter how dark it gets, doesn't matter how gruesome it gets or how horrible it gets, you keep your faith in the Lord Jesus Christ. You keep looking up because your citizenship is in heaven. And he said, we eagerly await a Savior from there, the Lord Jesus Christ. And the 21st verse says, who will transform our lowly body to be like his glorious body by the power that enables him to subject all things to himself. Our citizenship is in heaven, from which we await a Savior, the Lord Jesus Christ, who will transform our lowly body to be like his glorious body. How's he going to do that? By the power that enables him even to subject all things to himself. The kingdom of heaven. We're citizens of a kingdom. You may be a member, you may be a U.S. citizen, you may not be a U.S. citizen. I don't know. Kenneth, are you a U.S. citizen? Yep, good. Hallelujah. We have, from time to time, international students from East Central, and often we'll have students from foreign lands and foreign nations, and so I don't assume that everybody's an American, but if you are American, you have an earthly citizenship in this country, and it doesn't matter what anybody else says. My opinion, America is the greatest land, the greatest nation on earth. America is exceptional, my friend. All you must do is travel around the world, see how other people live, see how governments are, how forces govern their own people, and you'll realize that America is a tremendous place to live. But we have a citizenship in heaven. Jesus said to Pilate when he was on trial before Pilate, he said, my kingdom is not of this world. You remember reading that? It's not of this world. If it was, my followers would have fought to free me. But my kingdom is not of this world. Paul declared in Romans chapter 14 and verse 17 about the kingdom. He said, the kingdom of God is not meat and drink. In other words, it's not fleshly and physical and earthly. But it is righteousness, peace, and joy in the Holy Spirit. What's the kingdom of God? It's not meat or drink. It's righteousness, peace, and joy in the Holy Spirit. Come on and join us. Come on and enter this wonderful kingdom. Come on and be born again into the kingdom of God. King Jesus rules on the throne. In a kingdom like this, we don't understand kingdoms much in our day and age. We've been, for the most part, born in America, lived in America. We don't understand kingdoms. But the way kingdoms operate is a king has the final authority. The king has the final voice. The king has the final vote. And everyone else in the kingdom are subjects to that king. As I told you about Queen Elizabeth a moment ago, wherever she travels in the world, and all the different nations that make up the Commonwealth of Britain, everywhere she travels, those people are her subjects. She's the queen. Now, in recent years, the way it's worked in England is that England has a prime minister and England has a parliament. And so these are the men and women who make up the rules and govern the nation. And so the queen is more of a figurehead. And but yet in a kingdom, everyone is subject to the king or to the queen, whoever's leading, whoever's on the throne. And you and I are subjects to the Lord Jesus Christ. If we've been born into this kingdom, we're under his authority. We're submitted to him. By the way, when it comes to submission, the quicker you can learn to submit to authority, the better life's going to be for you. I heard a lone amen out there. You see, we're under authority all of our lives. In our family, our church, on the job, in education, in government, there is authority and there is those under that authority, and if you and I choose to submit to that authority, we have the blessings of God. We have the promises of God for submitting to authority. And so Jesus is king. This kingdom is not meat and drink. It is righteousness, peace, and joy in the Holy Spirit. Somebody say amen. In the Sermon on the Mount found in Matthew 5, 6, and 7, Jesus outlines the attributes of people who come under the rule of his kingdom. This particular sermon is the greatest sermon that's ever been preached, in my opinion. There's none greater. And I'm not alone in that. There are a lot of people who feel the same way. However, the Beatitudes found in the sermon are not they're not for salvation. They are, on the other hand, a way of life for true kingdom kids or true children of the kingdom. Let me say that again. Jesus outlines the attributes of people who come under the rule of his kingdom. So in that sermon, it's not a way of salvation. It is a way of life for true children of the kingdom. In this sermon, there are 9 direct references to the kingdom. Each of these are a sermon in itself, but let me just kind of give you what they are referencing, what's important, and then I'll give you the passage where you can find them, okay? For instance, humility is spoken of in the 5th chapter, the 3rd verse. Jesus speaks in the Beatitudes of those who are poor in spirit. Poor in spirit. Those who've humbled themselves, those who've emptied themselves. In 5:3. Then in 5:10, chapter 5, verse 10, we see another reference to the kingdom. We must be willing to suffer persecution. Oh, wait a minute, preacher. I didn't sign up for persecution. Well, there must be a willingness in the heart of every man or woman who's part of the kingdom, because how many of you know persecution will come? It's going to happen. If it hasn't happened to you already, you're living in a bubble. Real life, there are hard times, and there is suffering, and there's persecution. And we must be willing to suffer for the cause of Christ. Matthew 5:10. In Matthew 5:19, another reference to the kingdom in this sermon, Jesus tells us you must have an earnest attention to God's commandments. To God's commandments. Chapter 5, verse 19. Then in chapter 6, verse 9, Jesus teaches us how to pray. So he requires of us a life of prayer. Now this last week, this last 7 days, many of us have been fasting and praying. And we had the building open down on 14th Street for prayer. And some folks came by each evening and prayed there. Many of you prayed at home and on the job. And that's wonderful. That should be the way we conduct our lives. It shouldn't be a once a year thing when the pastor calls for fasting and prayer. We need a lifestyle of prayer. Can you say amen? And if you're not sure how to pray, you don't know what to do. Jesus taught us to pray in Matthew 6 and verse 9. He taught us what's been called the Lord's Prayer. You know, technically, that's the believer's prayer. Not the Lord's Prayer. It's teaching us how to pray. He says, say these words, repeat after me, follow after me, our Father which art in heaven. That's what he was teaching his disciples. So we must have a life of prayer. Speaking of the 330 building, I'd like to tell you some good news. How many ready for some good news? Last week, we were able to pay off the mortgage on the 330 building on East 14th Street. It is now free and clear. Hallelujah. Amen. Isn't that great? And it's because of your giving, it's because of your faithfulness, and we were able to double up on some payments and knock that thing out. Hallelujah. So this building is free and clear. That building is free and clear. Everybody say free and clear. There you go. Amen. All right. So a lifestyle of prayer is one of the 9. Then the next one is prioritizing spiritual values over the material. In Matthew 6:33, Jesus said this. That's what he said. Does that ever happen to you? Seek ye first the kingdom of God. I knew it would come to me. Matthew 6:33, come on. But seek ye first. Everybody say first. Now, we've taken that to mean first thing in the morning or first thing in the week. And that's okay. That's good to seek God and his kingdom and his righteousness. However, I believe Jesus was referencing a priority. First, we seek his kingdom. First, we seek his righteousness. Then all these things, Jesus said, all these things will be added unto you. I always like to pause and say, what things are we talking about? If you go back before 6:33, a few verses, you'll see Jesus is saying, I don't want you to fret about what you're wearing or about what you're going to eat. He said that when a sparrow falls, your father is knowledgeable of that. He says, your father has prepared for you. Don't fret. Don't stew. Don't worry about your future. But seek first the kingdom of God and his righteousness. And all these things will be added to you. Matthew 6:33, seeking the kingdom and seeking his righteousness. That's what it's all about. Amen? Amen. And then finally, which could perhaps be the most important of all, the nine references to the kingdom in the sermon, the greatest sermon ever preached, the Sermon on the Mount. Number nine is Jesus said we must obey the revealed will of God. Chapter 7, if you're taking notes, verse 21 through 23. Obey the revealed will of God. So let's recap. Humility, willingness to suffer persecution, attention to God's commandments, a life of prayer, prioritizing spiritual values over material, and obeying the revealed will of God. I gave you six. The other references are given in other points of the sermon. Now, before believers can exercise the authority that Christ delegates to us, we must first be willing to accept renewal in our souls and in our behavior, as well as rebirth through the forgiveness of sins. Michael and I were talking this week of individuals, not you guys like people, we weren't naming names, hallelujah, but we know, and you probably know, someone who's trying to work out their own salvation, someone who's trying to do good works, you know, but there's no faithfulness there. They've not committed their lives to Christ. Friend, listen, you can do all the nice things and all the wonderful things. You can be a good person, not cheat on your taxes, not cheat on your wife, don't kick your dog. You're a nice person. I'm going to tell you something. Nice people are going to go to hell when this thing is all said and done. There's only one way to salvation. Jesus said, I am the way. I'm the truth and the life. No man comes to the Father but by me. You can't get to the Father through your good works. Somebody say amen. You can't get to the Father through some other religion or some other lifestyle. You must be born again. You've got to come to God and acknowledge that you're a sinner and confess your sins, and God is faithful and just to forgive you of sin and cleanse you from all unrighteousness. He's a faithful God. Somebody say amen. So many Christians want authority, but they don't want accountability. They want a position and they want power without practicing the disciplines of prayerfulness and long suffering. So the call then to kingdom living and kingdom ministry includes the development of the Holy Spirit, fruits and gifts. Boy, talk about sermons. You talk about the fruit of the Spirit. You talk about the gifts of the Spirit. We could spend all day. Did anyone pack a lunch? And did you bring extra for me? That's the question. All right, let's look at a couple of verses I think will help us. In John 15, Jesus said in verses 5 and verses 8, that's kind of what I want to point out to you. He says, first of all, I am the vine, you are what? The branches. He's the vine, he brings life, we're merely branches of that vine. If we're producing fruit, we remain. If we're not producing fruit, we get pruned away. If you remain in me and I in you, Jesus said, you will bear much fruit because apart from me, you can do nothing. You can bear fruit when you're abiding in me. But if you're outside of me, you can't do anything. Then he said, well, we got verse 6 up there for you. Let's just go ahead and read it. If you do not remain in me, you're like a branch that is thrown away and withers. Such branches are picked up and thrown into the fire and burned. If you remain in me and my words remain in you, ask whatever you wish and it will be done for you. Wow, what a promise. This is to my Father's glory that you bear much fruit, showing yourselves to be my disciples. How do we show ourselves to be his disciples? By bearing much fruit. How do we bring glory to the Father? By bearing much fruit. Many of you are laying up treasures in heaven by your works, your giving, your faithfulness, your prayers. You're laying up treasures in heaven. Jesus taught us to do that. He said, listen, don't lay up for yourselves treasures on earth. because moths and rust corrupt and a thief might break through and steal. He said, but lay up for yourself treasures in heaven where those things don't happen. No thieves, no rust, no moths. You're laying up treasures in heaven. And I'm going to tell you something. There's coming a day when the chief accountant will look over the books and he will pass out the rewards to those of us who have been faithful. We'll stand before him one day at the judgment seat, not the great white throne judgment. That's for the sheep and the goats. That's for the lost, and it's determining hell or heaven. You and I are Christians. We've already determined we were guilty of sin. We confessed it. We trusted the Lord Jesus and his blood. We were born again. And so for us, there's eternal life. But there's also a judgment. It's called the Bema Seat of Christ. And in that particular judgment, there will be a time when we will come before the Lord and our works will be examined. And if our works are wood, hay, and stubble, they will be burned in the fire. They'll be lost. We won't be lost, but our works will be lost and our reward will be lost. However, if what we're doing for the kingdom of God is gold and silver and precious stones, in other words, if it's the right motivation and it's the right heart, and you're not giving just because everybody else is giving, you don't come to church just because it's a habit that you have, you don't witness of Christ just because you're supposed to, but I mean you seriously are laying up treasures in heaven, then that gold and silver and precious stones, that fruit that'll from your works will be given to the Lord, and a reward will come to you. You'll not miss your reward like the unfaithful servant, but you'll be rewarded one of these days. Now, I'm thankful there's a reward in heaven, but I serve God because I love him and he first loved me. Do you love him this morning? Amen. So that's John 15, 5 and 8, 5 through 8. Look at Galatians chapter 5, verse 22 with me. The fruit of the Spirit, what's this fruit you're talking about, Pastor? Well, here it is, it's defined. The fruit that the Spirit within accomplishes. I think it's the Amplified that says that. The work which his presence within accomplishes, okay? This is the Spirit of God working in man. He produces in us love. He produces in us joy. He produces peace. He produces forbearance or long-suffering or patience. He produces kindness. He produces goodness. He produces faithfulness. The others listed in 23, he produces gentleness and self-control. And against such, there is no law. These are fruit that the Spirit produces within us. So it's really easy to examine your life. It's really easy to look at, you know, check your heart and say, oh, wow, am I producing the fruit of love? It's actually bearing because the Spirit produces it. We simply bear it as branches of the vine. Are you with me? And so I'm trying to get the metaphor straight here so we can see it. But these fruit are born in our lives, and you just look at yourself and say, do I love people like Jesus loves people? Is there any joy in my heart? There it is in the Amplified. Well, whoever did that, I want to say congratulations and thank you and pat on the back. The fruit of the Holy Spirit, the work which his presence within accomplishes. Do you see that? You need to download the Amplified onto your phone. It's love and joy, peace and patience, even temper. Wow. I'm not going to ask for a show of hands on this one. But how many of us don't have a long temper? We're kind of short-tempered with people. How many of us, quit that pointing at your wife. I saw that. Quit poking with the elbows. I saw that. Well, let me tell you something. That's a work which the Holy Spirit within can accomplish. Maybe he wants me to be a more patient person. Do you think? Yep. He wants me to exhibit joy. Now, joy, I told you can preach on all of these, but joy is not not happiness. Happiness comes from an English word, Old English word, happenstance. And it refers to things, you know, that make you happy in life. All of the circumstances line up. I mean, you got to raise it and pay at the job, and you're feeling pretty good because you found your meloxicam prescription and you're taking them now, and the aches and pains are going away. Hallelujah, thank you, Jesus. And and there's air in your tires. One of our brothers, this last week, he was coming to see me in a meeting, and he called me and said, "I'm sorry, I got a flat tire." Man, don't you hate to get a flat tire first thing in the morning? But listen, if everything's lined up, then you're happy. Well, the joy that Jesus brings and the Holy Spirit produces in us as a fruit of the Spirit is evident whether the circumstances are good or not. Whether there's a reason to be happy or not. The joy of the Lord is our strength. Man. The fruit of the Spirit. So, let me just quickly tell you a few things, talk to you about a few things relating to the Holy Spirit. Jesus said in Acts 1:8, here's how you receive the power of the kingdom. He told his disciples, don't do anything until I send the Holy Spirit to you. And so 40 days after he had resurrected, he preached and walked to the earth for 40 days, and then he ascended to the Father from the Mount of Transfiguration. He ascended. And when he ascended, then he sent the Holy Spirit. And about 10 days later, on the 50th day after Passover, which was the Feast of Pentecost, which means 50, the Holy Spirit came, and he came in baptismal fullness. And here's what we read in Acts 1:8. He says to his disciples, "You shall receive power after that the Holy Spirit has come upon you, and you shall be my witnesses." That's why the Spirit has come. That's why the kingdom power of the Holy Spirit is evident in our lives, that we might be witnesses of him, that we might reflect his love and reflect his joy and reflect his peace. As the moon reflects the sun. So the moon doesn't have any way to generate light. It's just an orb up there in the sky. But when the sun hits it, you can see it and it lights up. There's the moon. What's it doing? It's reflecting the light of the sun. And some nights during a full moon, it gets so bright you can see around, you can see everything because that light has been reflected so well. And that's the way it is with us and God's power, God's presence. We are merely to be reflectors of that. We're merely to be witnesses of that. Somebody say amen. I was talking to Michael. Michael and I were preaching to one another the other day. He said, "Yeah, Dad." He said, "But think about the moon when it's on the other side of the earth." Oh, what we call the dark side of the moon. When it's not glowing, we can't see it. But guess what? You can see it somewhere in the world. It's dark somewhere in the world and you can see it. About 12, 14 hours away from us or so, you can see the moon. It's still there, still reflecting the sun. Nothing's changed. And that's the way it is with God. He's the Father of lights, in whom there's no variableness, neither shadow of turning. There's no eclipse in God's light and God's strength. And he gives that to believers. Listen, you can't see the moon, just because you can't see what's up there, doesn't mean that God is not doing something still in your life. Somebody say amen. So Jesus was presenting what we call post-resurrection teaching in Acts 1. He asked his disciples, they asked him, they said, "Is the messianic kingdom going to come now? Is this the ultimate kingdom that is to come?" And Jesus said this, "It is not yours to know the future, but it is yours to receive the Spirit's power." We want to know what the future holds. Jesus wants us to be filled with the Spirit. We want to look into who's the Antichrist and who's the beast and who fulfills that 666. We want to know all about that. It's okay to study that. I'm not saying it's not. But Jesus wants us Spirit-filled first. In fact, if you come to the book of Revelation, the book of Daniel, if you come to eschatology and end time Bible prophecy without an infilling of the Holy Spirit, you try to understand it yourself, you try to relate to it yourself, you just can't do it. I said you can't do it. Brother Schuyler is teaching right now on the book of Revelation in our quarter life group, which is our college age group that meets on Monday nights. They're going through the book of Revelation. He's a brave man for doing that. But you need the Spirit of God, and Jesus said you've got to be filled with the Spirit. Don't go anywhere. Don't do anything. Don't preach. Don't prophesy. Don't lay hands on the sick until the power has come. And I'm telling you, the power of God has come, and he is here. He's holding back the spirit of lawlessness. He's making sure that believers are taken care of before the wrath is poured out, before the vials are open. The Holy Spirit is. Three things he established real quickly, and then we're going to be done. The Holy Spirit is a person who gives power for assistance and ability. This power is given for serving. It's given for sharing the life of God's kingdom with others. Number two, the Spirit's power must be received. It's not an automatic experience. Okay? Now, the Spirit indwells every believer. Romans 8, 9 says, if any man have not the Spirit of Christ, he's none of his. And so we understand that the Spirit indwells every believer. Once you're born again, you have the Holy Spirit. But then he wants to fill and overflow those who receive in faith. John chapter 7, Jesus stood on the last day of the feast and said, come to me, all you who are thirsty, and out of your belly or out of your innermost being, out of your spirit, shall flow rivers of living water. And the next verse says, this spake he of the Spirit. Jesus was referring to an experience with the Holy Spirit that God wants to make happen in your life. The third and final point, when the Holy Spirit fills you with his power, you will know it. Jesus said it, the disciples found it to be true. In the book of Acts, the first chapter, second chapter, third chapter, all the way through the book of Acts, you see the disciples of Jesus, after they have received an inflowing, an influx, an infilling of the Holy Spirit, they overflowed. They were just like a river wherever they went. They were helping people. They were refreshing people. They were ministering to people because the Holy Spirit was in them. I want that Holy Spirit to be in me. How many of you want that Holy Spirit to be in you? Amen? Not just a little dab, not just a little trickle. I want a full rushing river coming out of me. So people are refreshed and people are touched and people are encouraged. Amen. Positive encouragement, like K-Love. Positive, encouraging music. Is that right, Sarah? Did I get that right? Amen. Stand with me, everybody. Would you bow your heads, please? If you're watching this video at home or somewhere and you've got a, if you can, get a quiet moment. Maybe take your phone into another room or something or log on to another computer. And because I want to pray with you, not only everyone in the room, but I want to pray with everybody at home as well. We okay? Yeah. I'm getting a thumbs up, and I'm not sure what that means. Okay. All right. Heads bowed and eyes closed and thumbs up. There you go. I want you to pray a prayer with me. I want to lead you in a prayer of salvation. I have led, I don't know how many people in 40 years of ministry. I don't know how many people we prayed with to be born again, to be saved, and to receive the infilling of the Holy Spirit. But I want to pray for you. I want to lift you up. And would you just take a moment and say this prayer after me? Jesus taught his disciples to pray after him, to follow his words. So please just say this. Just say, dear God, I thank you for the salvation that is provided through the blood of Jesus. I confess that I am a sinner. I am in need of salvation. I pray today that you would change my life. I believe God raised Jesus from the dead so I could have eternal life. And I receive now the power of the Holy Spirit in Jesus' name. Amen. Come on, let's just worship him. Thank the Lord. Sherry, can you lead us in that song this morning? Would you mind?
And all my life you have been faithful.
Yes.
All my life you have been so good. With every breath that I am able, oh, I will sing of the goodness. God,
come on, let's sing it to everybody. Lift your voice and sing with me.
All my life you have been faithful. All my life you have been so good. With every breath I am able, I will sing
of the goodness
of God.
Wow. Thank you, Lord Jesus.
I'm going to sing of the goodness
of God. Amen. Amen. The goodness of God. The goodness of God leads man to repentance. Right. That's right. The goodness, the gentleness, faithfulness of God. All those fruit we read about in Galatians 5, those are all fruit that Jesus bore in his life. And we, as reflections of him, you know, like the moon reflects the sun, we're to bear those, fruit in our lives. I want to pray with you now. And if you were here and you received Christ, I want to just give God the glory and praise him. And if you're at home and you prayed with me to receive the Lord, by all means, contact us and let us know that you prayed with us. And everyone else, I want to pray with you for a moment before we go, because we need, in this last day, an infilling of the Holy Spirit. We need the power of the Holy Spirit. Jesus sent him that he might empower us to be witnesses, to be those that people can look at and listen to. We can reflect Christ. So right now, if you need an infilling, a fresh touch with the Holy Spirit, I want you to pray with me. Just say it out loud. Say, "Dear God, I believe in Jesus. I believe you sent the Holy Spirit. I now receive an infilling of that Spirit. Work in me, I pray, Lord. I'm thirsty, and I need your water. I want to be a river of living water. I want it flowing out of me, Lord, in Jesus' name." Now, if you prayed that prayer, just lift your hands toward heaven and just begin to thank God for his power, his presence. He may give you a prayer language right now on the spot. This may be your moment. This may be your time. If he does, by faith, you speak it out. Don't worry about what someone around you thinks. It may not sound like English because it's not English. It is a heavenly language. God wants to give it to you as a sign that you have received the Holy Spirit's baptism for power. So receive it now in Jesus' name. Just receive it now in Jesus' name. The Bible says that Jesus breathed the Holy Spirit on his disciples. Just let him breathe on you today as his disciple. Thank you, Lord. We receive. We receive in Jesus' name. We receive in Jesus' name. Whew. My. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. We receive your power. We receive your anointing. We receive your touch, Lord. Thankful that you're with us today. Amen. Everybody said amen, 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 amen. Amen. Praise the Lord. All right, so Wednesdays, what we're doing, it's a midweek. We used to have midweek service. We've kind of done things differently. Now it's just an online service. We call it The Connection. And so if you'd like to join us, just tune in right there, facebook.com, life623/life623. Or it's on YouTube at the same time. Is that right, Sabrina? You premiere it on YouTube at the same time, if that's easier for you to find. We have a YouTube channel. It's the same. It's life623. That's how you find us on YouTube. And you might want to look at some of our previous messages. You can share them with a friend. That's pretty cool, you know. And if you like them, let us know. I've got some teaching on there of the end times we did in, what was that, April or May or something? Well, maybe it was August. It was one that starts with an A. Maybe it was August. I don't know. But anyway, I like that stuff. And you're welcome to check it out. Amen. Okay, so Wednesdays, that's what we do for adults. Young people who are 12 and up, our meeting downtown at the 3:30 building at the same time, 6:30 p.m. Now, they have live worship and a live message from Daniel Chenault, our youth pastor, and his team. And so if you know of a young person who really needs to get into a youth group, by all means, tell them about what's going on Wednesdays, and they will love it. They'll absolutely love it. All right. I'm going to ask Brother Steve to come back to the podium and lead you in the blessing of the day. Amen. I appreciate Brother Steve so much. He's got a wonderful heritage in ministry, having been a pastor a long time. 3 decades? Yeah, that's crazy. Bless you, my friend. Appreciate you.
Oh, how many enjoyed that word from the Lord today? Amen.
Praise God. I tell you what, we got some wonderful preachers and teachers in this church, and every once in a while I have the privilege of doing so myself, but I would rather hear Pastor preach than to preach myself. He is a great minister, and I appreciate his ministry so, so very much. God bless you today. Maybe you're in the category like I am, old school, when people didn't have a specific testimony to give and we had testimony services. They'd stand and say, I thank God that I'm saved, sanctified, and baptized in the Holy Ghost. And aren't you glad of that today? Praise God. Praise God. Let's do the blessing. Raise your right hand if you would, please. Hallelujah. Now may the Lord bless you and keep you. May the Lord make his face to shine upon you and be gracious unto you, giving you his peace. May angels go before you and goodness and mercy follow you all the days of your life. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. Amen. God bless you. God be with you.
Grace is waiting for you. Dance like a weight has been lifted. Grace is